worship today? Everybody at full? All right.
Good deal.
Let's all stand. Let's start our worship. And also, we're having a drawing right after service
out back. Many of you already put your name in it, but if you have not, be sure to put your name in it. After service, we got two big, huge snack packs that we are giving away to a lucky dad. We're going to draw their name right after service. So after service today, everyone can just kind of go back this way to the family center. Remember, we did that at Mother's Day. Remember, we'll do that again. Make sure everybody's name is in there. We'll mix up the names and we'll draw one out. Sound good, guys? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All right. If anybody, who wants to win that snack pack? I think everybody does. And all the kids want their dads and grandpas to win, too. That's for sure. Our offering box, as always, is in back right there underneath the clock. Thank you, thank you, thank you for your giving. We appreciate it so very much. Next Sunday, I believe it's next Sunday. Is that right, Ralph? We're having a cookout after service. Is that the 25th next Sunday? Is that right? That's the end of the month, so we'll have our monthly cookout. We want you all to come. Burgers and brats are going to be on the menu. That'll be provided. Bring sides and desserts like you did last time, and bring some friends, and it'll be a great time. We'll be right out there after the service. Williamsburg Community Days is coming up at the end of July. So remember, and we've got a sign-up board in the Family Center. We need like 40 volunteers. That's like all of us, right? We need like 40 volunteers because it's going to be a huge day. Check the board out. Those who are team captains, if you will, start recruiting people if you have any leftover slots to fill. Everybody get their connection card out. You should have got one of these in your worship folder. If you did not get a connection card, raise your hand real quick. We'll get you one. Okay, need one up front right here. Anybody else? Then this helps us in attendance. So if you would just fill out that information, if you have a prayer request as well, you can fill out that prayer request. And we're going to collect these in just a moment. So go ahead and fill that out if you would. Put your name on there and all the good information. I'm putting mine now. It's on there because she's busy right now. Those who are here today, those who are here right now, make sure you fill this out. That helps us in attendance and also allows you to fill out a prayer request, and it gives us information if anything changes on you guys. Sound good? Everybody got them filled out? I'm going to have Darren on this side over here, and I'll have Alan on that side. Take your cards and pass them to the outside. And we are going to collect those real quick. Thank you, gentlemen, for that. Put mine in there, Alan. Thank you. You're running down through there, collect those. We appreciate you doing that. We do that every Sunday. Some of you are like, what? Sunday night youth service next Sunday. You will want to be here. You'll want to have some young ones. It'll be a cool time. We'll have a live band up here. We'll be rocking it out. 5 o'clock next Sunday evening, right here. It's a good time. Everyone is invited. It's geared toward the youth, but everyone is invited that wants to come and hear a good message and hear some good music as well. Are y'all ready to do some more singing?
Yep.
Okay, four of us are. How about the rest of you? You ready to do some more singing?
Yeah.
We got to wake up after we ate that breakfast. Thank you, ladies. That breakfast was amazing, wasn't it? Good, guys? Yeah, good on hands. Very good. It was awesome. Right, we thank you so much for that. And we would do it again next week, but we're having lunch next week.
Yeah.
So don't forget to bring friends and food for lunch. Let's stand if you're able. Father God, we thank you so much for this time, Lord. We thank you that you are the good Father. Thank you, Father, that your presence is here, God, and we just give the rest of this service to you, Lord. Work and move in the way that you want. And may we praise you the way you deserve to be praised right now. In Jesus' name, amen. In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation. We believe. In this broken generation, when all is dark, you help us see. There is only one salvation. We believe.
conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and he's coming back again. We believe. Tomorrow, bless faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand has provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
You are faithful, God.
Because we are in your presence. Father, may we learn as we open your word here for just a few moments today, God, and give us our daily bread. Father, may you give us something brand new today, Lord. I'm asking that you would anoint me to give your word, and asking once again that you anoint the ears of the hearers, that they would hear what they need today. And Father, we will give you all praise and all glory. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen. Amen. You may be seated. Who's ready for children's church? All right. Have fun out there, guys. And gals. Isn't that a beautiful picture? Mm-hmm. And in the book of Genesis, where's Genesis at in the Bible? First. Very beginning, right? Genesis, the book of the beginning. In the book of Genesis, God tells Abraham, gives Abraham a promise. He says, I will make you into a great nation. You'll be the father of a great nation. Remember that story? And Abraham believed him. Sarah believed God as well. But there was one problem. Abraham and Sarah at this point had no children. How can I be, I'm sure Abraham thought, how can I be a father of a great nation with no children? I kind of where it starts. The word father implies that, doesn't it? You can say amen. Everybody still awake, right? Y'all doing good. You're tracking with me. I see you out there. You're doing good today. Let's see if we can keep it up for just a few moments. That was a good breakfast, though, wasn't it? Ladies, you are amazing. Thank you, thank you, thank you. But Abraham said, or Abraham and Sarah said, now, God gave us a promise, but we have no children. So they did what we would probably do. They decided to take things into their own hands, didn't they? And taking things into your own hands, back in that day, thousands of years ago, in that culture, it seems very strange, and it would be strange to us, but in that day, in that culture, if the wife could not have any children, she would oftentimes give one of her servants to the husband and say, have a father a child with her, then we will be able to have a child. It's kind of a weird thing, but that's what they did. So believing in God's promise, but taking it into your own hands, Sarah gave Abraham Hagar, her one of Sarah's servants. And Abraham and Hagar, they had a son, Ishmael. Have you ever tried to hear a promise from God and then say, okay, God, I'll take it from here? I'm glad we've never done that before. But in this, so now they have Ishmael, right? Kind of weird, isn't it, to us today? It's foreign to us, but that's what they would do back then. So now they got Ishmael. Now let's fast forward 13 years. God had given Abraham his promise, you're going to be the father of a great nation. They take God's promise, put it into their own hands. Now they've got Ishmael. Ishmael is now 13 years old, and now God comes back and visits Abraham again. And he says these words to Abraham. He says this, he says, Sarah, your wife, will bear you a son, and you shall name him Isaac. Call his name Isaac. I, God says, will establish my covenant with him as an everlasting covenant for his offspring after him. As for Ishmael, I have heard you. Behold, I have blessed him. And later on it says, but I will establish my covenant with Isaac, whom Sarah shall bear to you at this time next year. God reiterates his promise. I haven't forgotten you. It's been 13 years, but I haven't forgotten you. And we know, and I suspect that Abraham, probably himself, and we know Sarah, when they heard God say this, they probably kind of chuckled to themselves, didn't they? Because Abraham is now pushing 100 years old. Sarah's not far behind. Well beyond their childbearing years. And they probably kind of, and they did, they chuckled a little bit, didn't they? What I find kind of interesting in this is that if you look at the name Isaac, it means he laughs. I think God said, name this child Isaac, and God is saying, I'm God going to get the last laugh. Because they thought there's no way this can happen. It's impossible. So what do? Do we take God for his word, or do we try to work his promise with our own hands? That's tough for us, isn't it? We see in the story today, we see the story of Isaac and Ishmael. We see the story of Sarah and Hagar, and we see the difference between between living under the law, the old law, meaning you've got to work and earn your salvation, you've got to earn God's blessings, you've got to try to work it out yourself, versus living in grace, God's grace, believing his promise and allowing him to do the work through us and with Jesus in us. We see the difference there. God said, I will make you the father of a great nation. And everyone, all the nations, the entire world will be blessed through you. Abraham believed him. Sarah believed God. And we know that the Messiah came through that, who obviously blessed us beyond measure. So, God's plan was not for Abraham to have a son with someone else besides Sarah. That was not God's plan. God said, I'm giving you a promise. Abraham and Sarah would have been smart. They would have been wise to say, we believe in it, so we're going to allow this to happen. But they had to take things in their own hands. Once again, I'm glad we do not do that today. Aren't you? God, you said it, so I've got it from here. They kind of took over. Paul, we know who the Apostle Paul is, right? He's the church planter that we've been talking about the last few weeks. He would go to a town, plant a church, work it up. It'd be a house church. They would work it up. They'd meet somebody's house. They would get it going. He would leave that church moving and rocking and rolling. They'd be doing the good things. And he'd go to another town and do the whole thing all over again. And he would write letters. He would come and visit, but he would write letters back to him as well. And that's where we get the book of Galatians. It's a letter that Paul wrote to the church in Galatia. And we're in chapter 4 today. And in this chapter 4, Paul brings up this story. It's more than a story. It's an actual true event, but this event that happened in time with Abraham and Sarah, because the people that day, they would have known this story very well as well. So he brings it back up again in chapter 4. This is what Paul says to the Galatians in his letter. He says that his son, God, he says his son, Abraham's son, by the slave woman, that's Hagar, right, was born according to the flesh. In other words, you worked it out yourself. You put your own efforts in it. But his son by the free woman, Sarah, was born as a result of a divine promise. It happened only because God said it would happen. He says, these things are being taken figuratively. The women represent two covenants. Here we go. One covenant is from Mount Sinai and bears children who are to be slaves. That's the old covenant. This is Hagar. She represents the old covenant. Trying to do things yourself to earn your salvation, to earn God's blessing. Okay, that's that way. And he goes on to say, now Hagar stands for Mount Sinai in Arabia. It corresponds to the present city of Jerusalem. Paul is saying there's a whole lot of people still living under the old law. Even though Jesus has come to give us the new covenant, there are many people still trying to live under the old law, under the old covenant. He says, because she is in slavery with her children. But the Jerusalem that is above is free. The Jerusalem that is above, Jesus has brought us a new one, and Sarah is that one who represents it here. And she is our mother. Paul, once again, he is saying, if you are trying to fulfill the requirements of the law and earn God's favor through your own work, your own best efforts, then you are following the old law. We get stuck in that sometimes today. And he says, you are following the slave woman, if you will, the old law. That's before Jesus. But Jesus has come, and now we've got a new law we can live under. Now we can have a relationship with God. We don't have to try to work this set of rules that, once again, all of those laws that they had to go by, as good as you were, you could never do all of them. All the law did was tell you that you were not good enough in the end. That's all it did, because you would not be able to keep all of them. There was something on it you was going to break, I promise you. So as good as you tried to keep the law, you were not able to do it, because we needed something more. We needed something more. We needed Jesus. Amen, church? Now Jesus has come, so now we're under a new law, a new covenant. The old law is works. The new law is what? Grace and His mercy. And we can have that. Paul, he later on, he tells us in verse 31, he says this, therefore, brothers and sisters, and once again, I know I've told you this 100 times, but I'll probably tell you just about every time we see it. When Paul says brothers and sisters, he's talking to Jesus' followers. Okay? So if you are in the church, if you are a Jesus follower, Paul is talking to you here. He's saying, brothers and sisters, we are not children of the slave woman. We don't have to worry about the old law, about trying to keep the laws and all of that entailed, all that. We don't have to do that. He says, but we are of the free woman. And things begin to shift from works, our works, to His grace. We can see that start to shift. And it is our faith that saves us. Amen, church?
Amen.
And it is our faith that sustains us. And if we are to live in victory, which this whole message series is titled Victory, then what? We must learn to live by faith. So, the question becomes today, how do we do that? How do I go from the old law of works to the new law of grace? How do I do that? That was a long introduction to the message, wasn't it? Well, I got good news. I'm halfway done already. Can I get amen? Hanging there with you, all are doing awesome. There are 3 steps that we can take. You have them there in your worship folder. You can fill in the blanks as we go along. But there are 3 steps that we take. And we take these steps by faith. And if we do this, we find this in Paul's writing in chapter 4. If we do these 3 things, we will begin to step. Say step. We will begin to step into that freedom that God has for us, away from the law and into this newfound freedom of grace and mercy. Are you ready to go on this journey with me?
Yes.
If you're ready, say ready.
Ready.
All right, here we go. Number one, we need to do this. Accept the Father's love. We must accept the affection that God has for us, His love. Now, we all know that God is our Father, right? If you are a Jesus follower, He is your Father. If you are not a Jesus follower, He's not your Father, but He can be. All you have to do is ask Him to come into your heart and life, and He will do exactly that. But if you are a Jesus follower, He is your Father. We understand that. We say it. We sing it. We can quote it from the Bible, but sometimes we have a problem. Sometimes it's hard for us to believe it. Really believe that God is our Father. I mean, it blows my mind if I sit and think about it too long. God, you're my Father. It's difficult for some people to approach God as their Father. It's a loving, affectionate Father. Right? Have you ever thought to yourself, especially when maybe you don't do so good, and and my hand's already up, so you know I've been in this boat as well. But have you ever thought to yourself, God is not too crazy about me? I think he looks at me, he looks down at me, he says, Pastor Doug, you are the black sheep of the family. Ever felt that way? Or am I the only one? And we would all probably say, yeah, I've been there, done that, felt that way in our journey, in our walk of faith. Sometimes we feel that way, don't we? So how can I approach God as a loving Father that way? Well, do you know how God wants you to approach him? Paul tells us in this chapter. He says this. He says, but when the set time had fully come, God sent his son, Jesus, born of a woman, Mary, under the law. Mary was under the old law because Jesus had not come yet. To redeem those under the law. We were all under the old law. But now Jesus can redeem us that we might. Here we go. We're going from works to grace. You can see it right here. Listen to this. It says that we might receive adoption as sonship. It's going from works to grace. Can you see that right there? You can literally see it in those words. It's going from works. Now because Jesus is going to walk, we might receive adoption to sonship. And it's starting to shift to grace. And Paul says, because you are his sons, and he would say daughters as well. Because you are his and you believe in him, God sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts. The Spirit who calls out, Abba, Father. Abba. You know what that word means? It means dad. God wants you to approach him and say, Dad. Kind of crawl up on his lap. I got something to tell you. Boy, today was awesome. It was great. And God, if we get that picture in our mind, he would probably say, there's nothing more I want to hear, my child. I was there and I saw it, but please tell me again. Or maybe you go to him and just say, Dad, it was a rough day today. It was no fun. It was tough. And you just need to crawl up on his lap and you just need to rest for a moment. That's how God wants us to approach him, to be able to call him Dad, be able to call him Abba, be able to call him Father. Paul is saying you can have a personal, intimate relationship with God himself. We can do that through Jesus now. To experience freedom, you must first approach God as your Father, and we need to accept his love that he has for us. Even when we're like, I'm sure God looks at me as the black sheep of the family. Can I tell you something? I promise you he doesn't. He loves you on the good days. He loves you on the not so good days. And God wants us to approach him that way. Paul, he tells us this down in verse 7. Right after that. He says, so you are no longer a slave. We are no longer a slave to the law. But now we are God's child, and since you are his child, guess what? God has made you also an heir. What does that mean? That means everything Jesus has, everything that God has to offer us, it is now yours. Right? Here's the problem. We often picture God as someone who is sitting on his throne, way up there, and he is throwing lightning bolts. Right? Have you ever pictured God that way? Have you? Be honest. Have you ever pictured God as just being on his throne, throwing lightning bolts? That's the way a lot of people picture God. That's how we picture him sometimes. But you know how God wants us to, I'll get this straightened out here in a minute. But you know how God wants us to approach him? And we get this in Matthew, I believe it is. Remember when Jesus was there and the children wanted to come to him. Remember that? And the disciples were like, no, I'll stay away. Jesus got more important things to do. What did Jesus say? Jesus said, let the children come unto me, didn't he? And we have this picture of Jesus, and he's got this child on his lap. We love that picture, don't we? Isn't that a beautiful picture? We love that in our mind, and we think of that, and we think, oh, how awesome is Jesus. He loves the little children, and we're glad of that. Do you realize something today, church? God, our Father, wants us to be that child on His lap. So maybe you can picture yourself crawling up on His lap, because you are His child. Amen, church? And if we begin to think that way, if we begin to think that we can crawl up on the lap of God, and we can be that way, I think that will change our life. That will change us from that works of law to more to that works of grace. I don't have to keep the law now. I don't have to do all of this work myself. I can allow, through my relationship with Jesus, I can allow God to work in and through me. You see the difference there, church? So God wants you to crawl up on His lap and call Him Dad. Amen, church? So let's have that picture. We had that picture for children. Let's have it for ourselves as well. You want freedom this morning? Discover God's love for you. Accept His love for you. Amen? Number two, we need to do this. If you haven't already done this, I've done this a long time ago, but if you haven't, you need to do this. You need to lose your religion. I didn't say lose your relationship. I said lose your religion. It's not about religion. It's about a relationship with Jesus. Right, church?
Yes.
Amen? Here we go. Galatians chapter 4, verse 9. Paul says this: "But now that you know God, you are now a child of God, or rather that you are known by God, how is it that you are turning back to those weak and miserable forces?" Paul is saying, hey, Galatians, you brothers and sisters, I pulled you up out of that. I preached Jesus to you. You accepted Jesus. You had the new life, but now you're going back to what you used to be, what you used to know. He says, do you wish to be enslaved by them all over again? Or do you want to go back to that where you could never do enough? He says, you're observing special days and months and seasons and years. I fear for you, he says, that somehow I've wasted all my efforts on you. I helped get you out of that, and now you're going back to that. Why do we go back to the way we used to be? Well, Paul's telling them. Today, here's what I mean by lose your religion. There are some Christians who think that their denomination is the only way to do things right. I've never heard, and I hope I never will, here in the Church of Nazarene that we say, if you're not a Nazarene, you're not going to make it to heaven. We don't believe that. We believe there's going to be Baptists in heaven. There's going to be Nazarenes. There's going to be Pentecostals. There's going to be Church of God. There's going to be Friends, there's going to be Quakers, there's going to be Methodists, and then there's going to be Lutheran. We believe that. Amen, church?
Amen.
There are some people that believe their church is the only way to go, and that's what I mean by lose your religion. If you think that the Nazarene church is the only way to go, hey, I love the Nazarene church. That's why I'm here. I love our policies. I love our policy. I love what we believe in, what we stand for. I love that we hold that banner of holiness high, that we say, once you are a Jesus follower, you need to be different. You need to live different. You need to act different. You need to speak different. You need to post on social media different. Amen, church?
Amen.
I love that banner of holiness that we hold high. But we're not the only ones who have this figured out. Amen, church? So that's why I say you need to lose your religion. It's more than just the Church of the Nazarene. I would just say we just happen to do things the best. Right? I love the Church of Nazarene with all my heart. With all my heart. But I love Jesus more. See how that works? And I believe that my good friend who's preaching in the Southern Baptist Church right now, I believe he's going to be in heaven too. Amen?
Amen.
And he's crazy enough to believe that me as a Nazarene, I'm going to be there too. Amen? Because if your view of heaven is only your denomination, friends, you are narrow-minded. Amen?
Amen.
must be a believer in Jesus, must follow Jesus, must be trying to follow him the best of your ability. And if that is you, I don't care what church you walk in, what the name is over the door, you're going to be okay as long as you keep that up. That's what we believe. Amen, church? So, number one, you need to accept God's love for you and understand what that means. Crawl up on his lap and call him daddy, right? And you need to lose your religion. It's more than just your denomination. And number three is you need to return to your first love. Return to your first love. Paul tells in verse 14, first part of 15. He says this, and even though my illness was a trial to you, you did not treat me with contempt or scorn. He says, instead, you welcomed me as if I were an angel of God, as if I were Christ Jesus himself. Paul said, man, y'all just loved me so much. Your joy was evident when you decided and you realized and you understood, I don't have to do the law. I can now focus on my relationship with Jesus and his grace and his mercy. And then Paul says, where then is your blessing of me now? Paul's saying back then, when you were full of grace and when you were living in that grace, he says your life had joy in it, and now you're going back to the old way, back to the law. The joy has disappeared. Where is your joy? So we can ask ourselves that question today. Is our joy in Jesus as strong today as it was when we first met him? If not, Paul urges us to return to our first love. To take the focus back on Jesus right where it belongs. I've discovered this, church. I've discovered that when I'm living victory through faith, and I'm living under God's grace and in his mercy, that joy is never out of reach. No matter where I'm at, no matter what I'm doing, no matter what I'm going through, there is still joy there. Amen? It may be way deep down inside, but it's still there. So again, I ask this question to you. Do you want freedom? If you want freedom, return to your first love. Remember this. Being a Jesus follower is first and foremost about loving Jesus. Amen?
Amen?
And if you love Jesus with everything you have, all of the other things will begin to fall into place if we keep Jesus where he needs to be. So maybe if Jesus has fell down your list a little bit and your joy is not like it used to be, maybe through Paul, I can ask you that question and I can tell you the same thing. Return to your first love. Return to that when you first met Jesus and you were so in love with him. You were so thankful. Through faith, we need to approach God as our Father. We need to accept his love and his grace that he has for us. Call upon his lap from time to time. Through faith, you need to let go of your religion. What I mean by that is it's about a relationship with Jesus. And through faith, we need to return to our first love. And if we do those things, we can step into the freedom that God has for us. Do you believe that, church? If you believe that, say amen.
Amen.
So you've got those three things on your list. Allow Holy Spirit to search you. Allow Holy Spirit to bring to you if maybe there's something you need to change. Maybe you need to understand how God looks at you, how he wants you to approach him. If maybe there's something else in your way that's blocking your way to having that relationship with Jesus the way it should be. Or maybe your joy is just not as good as it was. You can get back to that. If you can do those things, I believe you will step into the freedom that God has for you. Amen, church? Let's pray. Father God, we come to you today, Lord, and we thank you. We thank you that you are our Father. Thank you, Jesus, that you love us so much. May we understand and may we see and may we accept that love from you, God. And Father, we are so thankful that we can focus on our relationship with you instead of focusing on all the do's and don'ts of the old law. We thank you, God, that you have come to redeem us from that. May we see, God, that it's not about a checklist, Lord, but it's about our relationship with you and allowing you, Jesus, to work in us and through us and all around us. And God, may we see, may we realize today, Father, that it is more than just religion, it's more than just ritual, God, it's about a relationship with you. Father, there are many of us who just need to return to our first love, to put you in this right space again. Give us that strength to do that, we pray, Lord. Thank you for who you are and what you've done in our life. God, we will give you praise and glory and admiration, for you, Father, are only one worthy. We thank you, Jesus, for redeeming us from the law and bringing us a brand new covenant that we can live in and through your grace every day. May we focus on you this week. In the mighty name of Jesus we pray. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen. Go and be Jesus to someone this week, church. We love you. If you are a dad, come up here, grab your Slim Jim Rose, and walk back here to the family center. If you have not signed up for the gift basket giveaway, make sure you sign up. We're going to draw that name here in just a few moments, and someone will get to take that home. We love you, church. God bless. You are dismissed.